I hope you had an amazing week, man. I hope you had an amazing week. I had an amazing week. It wasn't perfect, but you know, every time it wasn't, I felt his presence, and that just made it 100%. Would you please rise with us and let's raise our voices to the Lord.
One, two, three, four.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
Every blessing.
Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, the train and the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes and burns, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
You give and take.
You give and take. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Give and take.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be the name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Hallelujah.
Leviticus 11:44a. For I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, for I am holy.
Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour at your feet as treasure store.
My one defense, my righteousness.
righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Chapter 29, verses 10 through 13. Blessed are you, O Lord, God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, and the glory, and the victory and the majesty. Indeed, everything that is in the heavens and the earth, yours is the dominion, O Lord, and you exalt yourself as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. And in your hand is power and might, and it lies in your hand to make us great and to strengthen everyone. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. Let's call upon him now and declare the powerful name of Jesus.
Is the name above all names.
church.
What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name.
Hands up all over this house. Just raise our hands to God. Just worship Him. Just call His name out. Tell Him what's on your mind tonight. He's listening. He knows anyway. The name of Jesus.
What a beautiful name.
Above the words, above the music.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
What a beautiful name.
We exalt you.
Thank you, Father.
Jesus, my King. Your Lord, my Savior.
Just call to Him. If there's anything on your mind, He knows anyway. He knows your heart. He knows you love Him. And we know He loves us.
Thank you for your anointment. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being with us in all of our endeavors. And thank you for being with us tonight. Lord, please be with Pastor John and open our hearts, open our ears to receive His message. In Jesus' sweet name I pray to you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
It is a good night to be in the Lord's house. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Do you believe what you just sang about Jesus?
Oh, yes.
We're going to have a quick night tonight because it all comes from His lips to begin with. Have a seat. Be comfortable. You've probably got a big packet like this somewhere, and it's got 47 things in it that are going on this week, and there's 43 more that they didn't put in because there's always something going on here because you know what? We live in a community that needs Jesus.
Amen.
And we're doing the best we can to meet those needs. If you get bored this week, you're welcome to come out and help. If you find yourself with free time that you... Oh, gosh. Wow. That hurt. If you find yourself with nothing to do this week, come on out and help. I didn't need to be yelling anyway, did I? Okay, where's Dale Bonser? Dale. Come up here, Dale. Now, Pastor Eddie ought to be doing this, but he's hiding out because he's not sure he wants to be responsible for this. No. Dale got baptized last week. Amen. Hey, Dale. Hey, this is for you, buddy.
Dale.
That'll help you remember the day you got baptized. Amen. All right, that's me. Okay, let me see. Okay, so we got announcements. We got Dale. I think we're at greeting time. So real quickly, greet the folks around you. Make them feel welcome. Tell them I've heard you sing. It ain't so bad. And we'll go on from there. Okay. Gosh, I love that sound. Don't you? Where's our kids? I know I'm not Eddie. Kids, you're going to have to trust me tonight, okay? But I spend a little time with kids in my normal job. If you can call teaching music at an elementary school a normal job. Yo, Holmes. How you guys doing? You're all out of school now, aren't you? Mom and Dad don't say anything bad about teachers this week, do they? That's right. Not that they ever would, right? You know, sometimes we look at kids and we say, hey, that's the future of the church. Uh-uh. They're already part of the body. They're not the future. They are the church. Amen? It's amazing to me that we don't sometimes see where they fit in. And they're leading their friends and their families to Christ. As a guy who grew up in a non-Christian household, it is possible to lead your adults to Christ. Did you know that? You can tell mom and dad about Jesus. Of course, that means you got to behave at home. Yeah, that makes it kind of hard. That's probably why I was in my 30s before my parents got the idea. Would you mind extending your hand out toward these kids as we pray for them tonight and as they go to their lessons? Lord Jesus, we thank you for these children and the gift they are to us and to our community. And we just pray, Father, that as they're taught tonight, that you would strengthen their teachers, strengthen that time of fellowship, and help them to know how much they can trust you when everything else seems wrong. Lord, use us tonight as you see fit. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great night. This is pretty comfortable. I may just stay down here. And some of you are going, who is this guy? Okay. We'll give you the 5-cent thumbnail, okay? If you've been around New Hope for a while, you know that we're kind of growing in a lot of different directions, right? And by the way, didn't Kenny and his team and the text do a great job tonight? Oh, yeah. Amen. And I'm honored that in March or so, we decided that there might be a way that I could help those teams between the worship team here and at West and at Esperanza and kind of building some systems that all work together so that we can replicate that out to new places like Naples. And we were talking about Arcadia at the time, but that's probably it. So that's kind of my bailiwick, and you know, I'll jump in and play and sing and make some noise or whatever. But tonight, I apologize. I'm going to preach. No, I'm going to teach. I'm a teacher. And so if I walk by your seat, no spit wads, okay? You know, no straws, okay? Yeah. If you got gum, you had to bring enough for everybody. But this month in June, Eddie's going to go down to Naples and get things rolling down there. And you get to hear from four of us that don't do this on a regular basis. I'm number one. I drew the short straw, or you drew the short straw, and here I am first, okay? So, because you didn't get a warning. Now, you already know there's somebody next week, but you should come back anyway, because I know what they're working on, and it's going to be awesome. Next week, you'll see Nigel up here. I'm looking forward to that, yeah. Amen. Nigel, I love your spirit, brother. I've never seen this man without a smile on his face. Makes me wonder what he's up to. But, and then in 2 weeks, I believe it's Tony. Is that right? And then on the third week, Pamela will be wrapping up the series for us. And it's about being all in. Now, other than all in, unless I missed a memo, Eddie didn't give us any more detail than that. Okay, so if it's wrong, you got to blame us. Okay, and honestly, here's my goal. I'm not here to preach for 25 minutes. If I can change your heart and mind about one thing, I don't care how long it takes. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to be here an hour, because you're not that stiff-necked, are you? So here's what happened. I started with all in, and I had all these great ideas of where we were going to go and what we're going to talk about. And Jesus says, no, you're not. And I opened up the first scripture that I was going to use as a little side thing, and it went in my face. I went, okay, I guess that's what we're going to teach about this week. So we're going to be in Revelation 3. Now, it's one of the normal parts of Revelation, okay? You don't have to cut it apart or cycle it. It works. So let's start with the big idea. And yeah, I'm using notes. Sorry, Eddie. My memory's not as good as it once was. And I might even pull out my glasses if the notes get too small. Are you all in? Don't answer that out loud. Because I'll tell you, I'm not all in. I got things that are in my way to being all in for Jesus. Amen. But can we move tonight one step closer? Just one step to where Scripture seems to be calling us to be. Now, if you're anything like me, and I'll pray for you if you are, you just thought of at least one thing that's standing between you and where you believe God wants you to be. If you agree to that, say amen. Okay, so we're all on the same page. Okay, I'm not here to preach to you. Christianity is one beggar telling another beggar where they found bread. I found some bread this week. I thought I'd share it with you. Is that okay? Okay, and let's see if we can't move in that direction. So what does it mean to be all in? Well, let's look at some worldly, sorry. The first thing that came to my mind was, do you remember poker was real big on TV for a while? And the big tense moment was when the guy pushed the chips all in, right? Took the whole pile and shoved it in the middle of the table. Hey, if you don't make it at that point, you're done, right? There's a lot of people that have gone to Vegas in a $35,000 car and come home in a $500,000 bus. You know what I'm saying, right? No, they didn't buy the bus. They just bought a ticket on the bus. Okay, my dad used to go to a place called Tunica, Mississippi. You ever heard of it? It's like Vegas in the South. And now my dad was not a gambler. He'd put $200 in his pocket and go enjoy himself. And when the money was gone, he stopped. So he wasn't all in at all. He wasn't even as all in as he thought he was, because my mama knew which pocket he put his winnings in. And she'd go take out of his winnings pocket when he wasn't looking. And when he ran out of $200, one night she had $800 in her purse. Yeah, he wasn't near as all in as he thought he was. I'm not near as all in as I think I was. Okay? In sports, it's the Hail Mary, isn't it, guys? Football. Gosh, the Bears stink. Sorry, I'm a Bears fan. I grew up near Chicago. But yeah, but if you go back about 30 years when I was a kid, about 1985, they were amazing. Okay? And you throw the Hail Mary, you're all in because you got nothing else, right? You're in. Here's my last one. Marriage. Or if you're a fan of The Princess Bride, it's marriage. Yeah, okay. How many want to admit to being married? I'm proud of it, okay? Because if you knew who I was married to, you know I'm married way up. Okay? Yeah, amen. Amen. I'm not going to argue. But there's phrases in there that sound like all in. Forsaking all others. Till death do us part. In my old job, I used to do some weddings on a fairly irregular basis. And a couple came to me one night, about 2 days before the wedding, said, yeah, we need to take that till death do us part thing out of the vows. I said, sorry, you got the wrong guy to do the wedding if you want that out, because, you know, it's supposed to be permanent. Now, we all know people that it's not permanent for. Not judging. I'm just saying that God's original intent was one man, one woman, one lifetime. Okay, so I wasn't game to pull that one out. I wouldn't marry couples that had a prenuptial agreement. Think about it. How are you in it for life if you've already got your plan to get out? That was just my thing. Because, you know, we had 7 other guys on staff, and they didn't need me to do weddings. That was okay by me, okay? But here's my thought. If we can be all in on cards, or we can be all in on a sports event, or we can be all in on, frankly, fallible other people, how much more so could we be all in on Jesus? Amen? Thank you. Yeah, please talk back so I know you didn't fall asleep, because I know I'm not the most scintillating speaker in the world, and I just get lost. So, does God want us to be all in? Oh, come on, man. That sounds kind of radical. I mean, all in? Everything? What happened to moderation in all things? Oh, book of second opinions, right? Because you hear this, oh, you know, moderate, a little bit of this, a little bit of that moderation. Man, Jesus was the worst moderate I ever saw. He got everybody mad. I kind of have that gift, but not for as good a reason as he had. So as I was digging into this concept of all in, a passage of scripture, Revelation 3, that I'd kind of meant to use to just touch on something, kind of took over the whole enchilada. Okay, so we're actually looking at Revelation 2 and 3, and there's 7 notes to the 7 churches. Not if you know what I'm talking about. Not if you don't know what I'm talking about, because you can go home and read it later and just catch right up. Okay, so they write these 7 notes to the 7 churches in Asia Minor. Each of the 7 messages concludes with this phrase. Yeah, that's the one. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Now, reach up here. You got one or two? Okay, so the Spirit's talking to you, us, me, right? Say, the Spirit's talking to me. Oh, that was lame, y'all. I said, the Spirit's talking to me. There you go. Okay, I just making sure you're still with me. Okay, so because the message is not just for that time, because as you look at the 7 churches, you find out, wow, they're a lot like us. Okay, so we're digging in there. So let's dig backwards, because I think better backwards. So see if you can stay with me, if that's okay. So by the time we get to the 7th church, John pauses to remind us who's talking. So in chapter 3, verse 14, he says, and to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen. Now that's the Old Testament Amen. That's thus saith the Lord. Because in Scripture you see the Amen and the Amen, right? If you've heard that phrase, there's God's Amen that says, let it be. And our Amen, it says, yes, Lord, as you will it, let it be. Amen. Okay, so we're, amen. We're there. And I'm getting email. I don't need email right now. Thank you. The words of the Amen. So who's the Amen? Jesus. Jesus is the Amen. He's God's let it be. Thank you. Okay. It says, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness. Now, that word faithful and true witness only shows up one other place in Scripture, and I'm not going to belabor you with it, but it's Jeremiah 42. And it's talking about God being a witness between two parties of people, actually between himself and a party of people. And this party of people said, Jeremiah, you go to the Lord and whatever he says to do, we'll do. And let him be the witness against us if we don't do it. That sounds kind of radical and out there on the edge, doesn't it? Because if you've just seen God wipe out an army and you say, okay, whatever he says to do, we're going to do. And if we don't do it, he can do whatever he wants to us. Yeah, you've kind of dug a hole at that point, have you not? You're tied into it. And finally he says, who is the origin of God's creation? Now, if you go back to John 1:1, Jesus is the origin of John's creation, or God's creation. Amen? It says, in the beginning was the Word. The word in Greek is logos. In other words, not only was it the spoken word, but it was the breathing, living word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. Can I beat a side answer here for just a second? Science, evolution, creation, we get into this whole discussion, right? If you're going to say that creation didn't happen the way that Genesis says it happened, then you got to deal with who Jesus is. Because if creation didn't happen the way Genesis says it happened, Jesus is not who he claims he is. And that's a problem for us, isn't it? Enough said, we'll have that discussion another day. Okay. So we've been digging backwards. So what does Jesus say? Revelation 3, verse 20. Listen, I'm standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into you and eat with you and you with me. That's a great evangelism verse, isn't it? No, sorry. Now, I grew up in an old Baptist church, and I'd have been right there with you. But you put it in context, that's not what he's saying at all. He's not saying, oh, because he's talking to the church, right? These are people that are already in Christ. So what? Let's look at the whole context. Let's back up to measure. Sounds like a musician. Let's back up to verse 19. It says, I reprove and discipline those whom I love. Reprove and discipline doesn't sound like any fun at all. You ever been reproved or disciplined? If not, you're probably a good time on Saturday night. Okay? Yeah. Be earnest, therefore, and repent. In other words, Jesus is saying, if you're doing the things we just talked about, which we haven't read about yet, because like I said, we're kind of going backwards. Stay with me here. Be earnest, therefore, and repent. Listen, I'm standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into you and eat with you and you with me. In other words, the people that are going to sit at the table with Jesus are the people who are going to repent from the thing he just dinged them for. Are you with me still? Have I gone too far backwards so far? Okay, good. There it is. I'm going to break down and get the glasses out in a second. Listen, I'm saying, there are knife, hear my voice? Okay. To the one who conquers or overcomes this problem, I will give you a place with me on my throne. Wow. Just as I myself conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Let that soak in for just a second. I get to sit at Jesus' table and eat from his food. I get to sit at Jesus' throne and reign and rule with him. If I can just beat this one little thing, what is it, right? Amen? I feel like I lost you there somewhere. Okay. So here's what he said. Remember, we're talking about all in, right? He says, I know your works. You're neither hot nor cold. I wish you were either cold or hot, but because you're lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. That didn't sound like any fun at all. That doesn't sound like being all in at all, does it? I mean, he's better you were cold than that you're lukewarm. So because you're lukewarm, I'm sorry, for you say, and gosh, as I read this, folks, I saw us, not you and me, but us, our culture. You say, I'm rich. I've prospered. I don't need anything. But you don't realize that you're wretched and pitiable and poor and blind and naked. Do you feel it? Doesn't feel good at all. And not to be flippant, but there's good news and bad news. OK, Okay? The bad news is in 2,000 years, we haven't changed a whole lot. The good news is 200 years ago, they were having the same problems. And I shouldn't have said 200 years ago because I wanted you to figure out how old this statement was. But it says, we've forgotten God. We vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these things were produced by our superior wisdom and virtue. We've become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming grace and too proud to pray. That's Abraham Lincoln at the depth of the Civil War. It's still us, isn't it? It's still our culture. It's what we're dealing with. Now, there's the dark and gloom of it. Are you feeling the need to turn around at all? I am. I've been chewing on this all week. Yeah, for about 3 weeks, actually. So what do we do? Well, fortunately, that's not the end of the scripture. Okay, so he goes on in verse 18. It says, therefore, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire so you may be rich. Because he told us our problem was that we were poor beyond our wildest dreams. And he says, we can still be rich. He says, buy white robes to clothe you and to keep the shame of your nakedness from being seen. Think about that. Whatever it is that we've done, Jesus just covers it over. Yeah, he washes us clean, and he chooses to forget. But sometimes I don't forget, right? But you put the robe on and everything looks good. You know, that's why when you go to graduation, everybody wears a robe. Because not all the kids have a coat and tie. Everybody looks good, okay? Jesus is saying, look, I'll give you the robe. All you got to do is take it. And he goes on, he says, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. And in other words, he says, not only am I going to make you wealthy again, not only am I going to clothe your nakedness, I'm going to open your eyes so you can see. Now there's an old hymn, open thy eyes that I may see. Okay, yeah, I'm showing my age again, aren't I? Okay, but you get the idea. So Jesus is saying in our indifference, we think we have it all together, but in reality, we're falling apart. Amen, I'm guilty. And because we are lukewarm, we don't even realize it. So I don't know if this is where Eddie envisioned all in going, but this is where it took me. Here's my favorite guy in the whole Bible, Peter. And Peter was messed up. So John, you could have picked a better hero. Yeah, but he does stupid things like I do, and it makes me feel better. Okay? Peter denied Christ. Peter, you're going to deny me 3 times before the sun goes. No, Lord, never. Boom, boom, boom. Can you imagine Peter in that moment? In fact, we see later where Jesus goes to restore him, right? He says, Peter, feed my sheep. In other words, Jesus said, I trust you, brother. I trust you. Feed my sheep. You've been through the fire, and I'm giving you something important to do. He stuck his foot in his mouth. Well, I don't know anybody like that. Oh, wait. Yeah. You know Peter wasn't perfect, and he knew he wasn't perfect because Peter had a mother-in-law. Went to Peter's house. His wife's mother was sick. Jesus healed her, right? Peter had a mother-in-law. Now, I love my mother-in-law. We get along great, but she ignores a lot of my faults. That's good because I got plenty of them. Anybody have a mother-in-law that knows their faults? Yeah, no, let's not even go there, right? Okay, but before we're too hard on Peter, he got the name Peter because it sounded like Petros, like a rock. And I believe Jesus was saying that on the rock of his confession, he was going to build his church. Wow. Wow. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter, no man told you this. Only the Holy Spirit could tell you that. You're the rock, and I'm going to build my church on you. Peter was weak enough to deny Jesus on the night of the arrest, but he not only founded the church, but he followed Christ to the cross. And I don't know if you know the story, but Peter said, look, crucify me, but if you're going to do it, crucify me upside down, because I don't deserve to go to death the same way my Lord did. Ooh, that sounds kind of radical. And for people that say, well, you know, the disciples and all the other people, they just kind of towed the party line, and Jesus wasn't really resurrected. Man, if you go back and look, a lot of them went to their deaths defending that statement. They still are. You're right. But it would have been real easy in the first century to deny the resurrection of Christ. But you can't find a record anywhere of anybody recanting the story. That's pretty amazing to me. So, We're almost done. Are you ready? Here's what I love about Peter. You know the story, right? They're out on the lake, and the water's going like mad, and the boats aren't that big. You ever been out in the rough water on a small boat? Ain't no fun. And then here comes a ghost walking across the water. Well, it ain't no ghost. It's Jesus, right? And Peter recognizes him. He says, Lord, if it's you, call to me and let me come out to you. See, Peter got out of the boat. Peter may have lost his will along the way, and he may have looked down at the water and got distracted and sunk. But of everybody in the boat, Peter's the only one who got out. So here's what I'm asking you to do. Well, John, if we're going to go all in, we got to do more. We got to be more. No. You haven't heard me. Stay with me here. This is important. When you push the chips all in, the last thing you do is let go. When you throw the Hail Mary pass, the last thing the quarterback has to do is let go. Sorry, but when you walk down the aisle and say, I do, anything that came before, you better let go. Otherwise, you're going to pay. Okay? But please understand, Peter was all in because when he threw his legs over the side of the boat, he let go and trusted Jesus to take care of whatever it was and to put him wherever he needed him to be to do whatever he was calling him to do. So I'm going to ask you tonight, that thing you thought of earlier that you thought maybe was stepping between you and Jesus and where he would have you to be all in, is it time to let go? Is it time to let go? No one can answer that for you. I can tell you this. If God's calling you to let it go and you do, you will never regret it. And if your spirit is saying let it go and it's not what God had in mind, you still know yourself pretty well. It might be a good thing just in the day and night in and outs of life to consider, do I need to let this thing go? So here's what I'd like to do. We're going to play a song like we typically do here at the end of the service. You can stay where you're at and sing along. The altar's open down here if you want to come and kneel and pray. I'm sure there's people that would come and pray with you if you wanted. But let's think about that one thing that maybe we need to let go of, that we could be more all in for Jesus.
Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me.
The King of Heaven wants you. How awesome is that, right? I was just happy if I could get a girl to go to homecoming with me. King of Heaven wants me? How awesome is that? Some of y'all nodded off during the song, didn't you? Okay. Here, let's do this. We're done. That's it. Okay? You're shocked. I know. It's my wife's the most shocked person in the room. She knows I can go this long without notes. Anyway, let's pray together, and we'll be dismissed. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you want us, and that even when we're lukewarm, somehow you still want us. It's your preference that we'd repent, that we'd be more like you, that we'd be more in line with who you've called us to be. But we're so broken. But you heal, and you fix, and you cover, and you invest. And somehow we begin to look like you. So as we leave this place tonight, Lord, may your Spirit go with us. And may the words that come from our mouths be your words. And may the work that comes from our hands be your works. And may you open our eyes and open our hearts to the world you've put us in, that we might serve you through it. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. God bless you, folks. Have a great weekend. Thank you so much.